and you'll sign off then. Okay.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Bob Shrum. I'm the Warshaw Professor of Politics and the director of the Unruh Institute of Politics at the USC Dornsife College of Letters, Arts, and Sciences.
And I'm Sherry Bebitch Jeffe, and I'm at the USC Price School of Public Policy, where I am, take a breath, the professor of the practice of public policy communication. And we're...
You know, Sherry, that reminds me of something I used to say in Washington.
Which was?
And it applies to both of us. The longer the title, the less important the job. President of the United States.
You did not hear that.
Deputy Assistant Secretary of State for this, that, and
whatever.
The next thing.
Yeah. Well, but we like to hide behind our titles. We're really very important, and that's why we're here today.
So let's get to the primary. Let me start off by asking you, what happened to Antonio Villaraigosa, the former mayor of L.A.? A lot of people thought, for months, this looked like it was a two-way deal between him and Gavin Newsom.
Right. You're right. And, you know, it's one of the things I'm looking at. Where did Antonio's mojo go? Well, I went into the election day saying that my scientific gut was saying Antonio is not going to make it into one runoff. Why? The fire in the belly, the rock star atmosphere that surrounded him when he first got involved in Los Angeles politics did not seem to be there. He seemed old. He really didn't resonate with voters. He was ironically looked on as an example of the old school establishment Democratic politics, which is somewhat out of favor with the, shall we say, the liberal base of the Democratic Party. I don't think he ever really got a message beyond, I'm real cool and I'll do stuff. And I've already done stuff. There never was that kind of spark, that kind of connection that he needed to reignite in order to move people. Also, look, Gavin Newsom's campaign was just about flawless. I mean, really, he started campaigning 2 years ago. He was way ahead. He had a solid home base in the San Francisco Bay Area. He raised money like crazy. He courted the progressive left, the teachers' unions who despise Antonio Villaraigosa, the nurses' union, with his focus on single-payer health care. He moved the Democratic base, the, shall we say, the new Democratic base, I think, more successfully than Antonio did. And there's a good a lesson in this, Bob, and I'd love to know what you think about it. You know, there may be a sleeping giant. There may be a Latino electorate. But like every other electorate I've ever looked at in campaigning in politics, they simply do not march in lockstep with another member of their group. And there's a lot of hostility, particularly here in Southern California, particularly among Latinas, about Antonio Villaraigosa's private life. And I think that fed into it too.
I think the moment will come in California, inevitably.
I think so.
When Latinos and Latinas will assert themselves, will see to it that there's a governor or a senator will assert themselves so that they elect a governor or a senator. But I want to go back to Antonio for a minute and then talk about Newsom. I think three things happened to Antonio. First, there was an assumption by the proponents of the top two primary that it would operate a certain way, that somehow or other it would produce moderate candidates. And the mistake in that, in my view, was, and you saw, by the way, that there were people like Meg Whitman, the Republican nominee for governor, who was in 2010 against Jerry Brown, who was for Antonio. But the mistake is that rank and file Republicans,
right,
when they walk in, look for someone with an R after their name. And he didn't fit that. Number two, I think that Republicans were just waiting for a signal.
Exactly.
And they got a signal from President Trump.
From Donald Trump.
Who said, you have to be for John Cox.
He gave him legitimacy.
And that was amplified by Gavin Newsom, who then ran ads against him saying he's too conservative for California. It was a great way to push up. And I did one of those a long time ago in a race in Kansas where we knew we would lose to one guy and beat the other guy, so we made sure that the guy we could beat got nominated. But the third thing is, and I think this is really important, Antonio struck me, and I like him, but he struck me as never having developed a powerful, coherent, and compelling message. Right. I would watch the ads and I would think, it's like he's running for re-election as mayor of Los Angeles.
Here I am, is what it all was. Well, good, we know, you know, those who don't know who you are want to know more. Those who do know who you are don't have to know more.
Yeah, but you had to have some vision of the future and where you were going to take the state. I do think Newsom ran a very smart campaign. He is, in my view, almost beyond doubt going to be the next governor of California.
You know, I've learned never to say
I know, I know.
Particularly after 2016.
Well, I went through the same thing in 2016. But this one is...
Look, the arithmetic says you're right.
Hillary Clinton had leads of, except in our poll, the USC Dornsife LA Times poll, had leads of 3, 4, 5, 6, and everybody was saying, well, that means she's won.
Well,
this, I think we're going
to. They were wrong, and in essence, what you were measuring was the popular vote, and that's where you were wrong because you had Trump ahead.
No, but what the
you
poll,
didn't
what
go
the
state
poll,
by state
what the
by
poll,
state
what
by
the
state.
Poll did was find all of the. In fact, it was reweighted after the election. It turned out to be quite accurate, but what the poll found that other people were missing was pockets of rural voters, older voters, and it's because of the methodology of the poll, which people are recruited in a large national panel. They don't opt in. They opt in originally, but they don't opt in for each individual poll. And if they don't have a pad, they're given a pad.
Mm-hmm.
And if they don't have internet service, they're given internet service. So that enables you to reach people you otherwise might not reach. But my major point here is, if you're going to talk about who's going to be the next governor, and we can spend some more time on this, the likely arithmetic here for Gavin Newsom is overwhelming compared to the arithmetic in the Hillary Clinton Donald Trump race.
What does that mean compared to the arithmetic?
Because
of turnout, of registration.
No, we're talking about the basic.
Compactness,
the basic composition of the electorate.
Well,
the Republican Party in this state is the third party now. It's about 25% of the electorate. And when you looked at the national polls, which people were relying on in these predictions, of, you know, there's a 70% chance, or the Princeton Consortium a 99% chance Clinton was going to win. In fact, her lead in those polls was 3, 4, 5, and didn't account, as you pointed out, for the Electoral College.
Right.
As I know all too well from the Gore campaign,
right,
you can win the popular vote, and I actually think we won the Electoral College too, but the Supreme Court stopped the counting. But you got to win the Electoral College to be president. Let's stay on California.
Okay, that's cool. And I also want to say that before this election day and following through, no offense, I'm not even going to listen to most of the polls. I've never seen the polls so far out, in and out, and around. They, you know, they're basically right now, because of all of the different technologies, because of the use of cell phones, because of your discussion of who has and doesn't have the internet, they're the astrology of politics.
Well, I think that if you do it a certain way, you can probably get to a level of accuracy, and there's not one method that will do that.
That's right.
But there are several methods that you could use, but they're all expensive. And a lot of polls right now, especially polls that are sponsored by the media, are done at very low cost. And the result is that you don't do any of the things methodologically that you have to do to check on things.
Mm-hmm.
So
let's get off it and let's go back.
Well, that's what I said.
California.
Let's go back to California.
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be fun.
What about the Senate
nasty
race?
It's going to be brutish. What about the Senate race?
Well, okay, let's stay on the governor's race if you want.
No, that's fine. I mean,
Cox yesterday said Jerry Brown and Gavin Newsom are turning California into Venezuela. Do you think that's a great argument for them?
No, of course not. I mean, we're the fifth largest economy in the world. We're humming along. We do have a coastline. Maybe that's what he's talking about.
I mean, I was on television yesterday with someone who said, a Republican who said, well, you know, we're going to do very well here because Los Angeles, and he lives in Orange County, Los Angeles, he said Los Angeles is a third world country. And you sort of want to look at him and say, A, that's not a very persuasive argument to advance if you're trying to get votes. And B, it's just not true.
It's not credible coming from a very wealthy, older, white man, Republican, who can self-fund his own campaign if he so chooses. It doesn't resonate. It's kind of silly. But it's awful Trumpian, don't you think?
Yeah, but why would you want to be Trumpian in a state that despises Trump?
I wouldn't. I certainly wouldn't.
Look, I understand.
But you're talking about, look, it got him to the runoff.
Right. He made a bargain with, Cox made a bargain with the Trump.
With the devil, yeah.
And it got him into the finals, and it's going to be an enormous lead weight around his neck in the general
election. It's an albatross. As helpful as it was to Cox in the primary to have the imprimatur of President Trump, it's going to be very difficult for him in this state, which so despises the president.
I don't agree.
And he despises
it. I don't agree with you. I think difficult is too mild a word.
I think it's close to
impossible. You say it's going to be a brutal, nasty campaign. Yeah. Why?
Look at the primary. I mean, people, what I have seen, this new wonderful term, gamesmanship, which I always knew as campaign dirty tricks, and I think you did too, it appeared to work. People had horrifically ugly opposition ads. You had Republicans funding Democrats to pull votes away from other Democrats, hopefully to move a Republican in, and the National Democratic Party did the same thing to Republicans. I mean, what is it? The fish rots from the top. Look what's going on in that on the national level, and we're going to see it trickle down into the campaigns in every state.
I think it's
certainly in California.
I think it's a product of the top too, because you could manipulate the system. So, for example, if Dianne Feinstein, the people who were for her, it had an independent expenditure,
right,
they might have been able to spend money, spend it to promote Bradley and keep it from being an all-Democratic runoff with Kevin DeLeon.
And actually, I believe this is the highest independent expenditure total in the state's history in this primary. So they figured it out.
Yeah.
And they figured it out. And that's another reason I think it's going to be nasty, brutish. And the question then becomes, how do the voters react to that? And which voters react how?
But who's going to, I think it's possible that Newsom will be able to run ads that will, negative ads that will resonate with California about Cox. And Cox's ties with Trump, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, but that helped Cox in the primary. It's going to hurt him in the general.
Exactly.
And Cox is going to, it appears to me from what he said yesterday, going to run ads about what a terrible place California is. I think that's a big problem. Now, there is one issue that might help them. Gas tax.
Well, yeah.
There's going to be a repeal that's going to, repeal ballot measure is going to make it.
Onto
the ballot.
Yes.
Yeah, it will.
But it's up there. It's the next to last step. The question then becomes, can the opposition to the repeal craft a message that resonates locally, look, you're not going to get this bridge. Look, this highway is never going to be finished if we don't have the money.
I think that's exactly right. As long as this is, do you want to keep or repeal the gas tax? The answer in our data is they really want to repeal it. But if you turn this into bridges, roads,
infrastructure
and the economy, because you need
exactly
to modernize this infrastructure to keep California at the forefront of the economy. But I'm dubious about that. Is I'm old enough to remember 1978 and Jerry Brown in the primary and virtually the whole political establishment.
The tax cutter.
Yeah, all campaigning against Proposition 13. The day after he turns around and he says, I'm going to protect it, I'm going to keep it. And he did then and he has now. So people have the power because of the ballot process here. to repeal the gas tax. They don't have to vote for John Cox to repeal the gas tax if they want to.
That's true.
And that's what happened in 78. Brown had been against 13, and he got reelected overwhelmingly.
And there were a whole mix of factors involved in that, including that Brown and the legislature just dragged their feet and finally came up about a minute and a half before the election with an alternative. But you said something that struck me as very interesting. Donald Trump said one of his priorities was infrastructure and infrastructure repair. Does Cox go around saying,
down here in Los Angeles, you've had two ballot measures to the credit of the voters passed by two-thirds votes to raise taxes to deal with homelessness, and you have gas prices going up because of the marketplace. Mm-hmm. So I think it's going to take a lot. The business community is for this, for the gas tax and infrastructure investment.
They support the gas tax.
They're for it. And they think you need the infrastructure investment. So are progressives. It's going to take a major campaign and a lot of money, I think, and it has to emphasize exactly what you were talking about.
Exactly.
It has to emphasize the outcomes, not the means. The tax increase is the means. The outcome is a stronger economy, better roads, the bridge isn't going to fall down while you're driving across it. I mean, that's where it's going to have to go.
So, like every other campaign, I think I hear you saying it will depend on money, media, and message, and who wins each. And at that point, let's talk about what may or may not be the impact of the issue of single-payer health care.
I think people like the idea in general. Then you tell them it's going to result in your taxes going up, and they don't like it so much. Then you tell them, by the way, you won't have to pay anything for your medical care anymore. And then they go back to liking it more. I don't know how much of that is going to be central in this campaign. I think it was central
either.
In the primary. I don't know how central it's going to
Although,
be in the general
you know,
election.
I didn't hear much about it in the Democratic primary anyway.
Well, but Newsom, there was a very clear difference between Newsom and Villaraigosa on.
Oh, yeah. I guess, and it boiled down to who supported whom.
Who was for single payer and who
right.
wasn't.
Right, and I mean in terms of the interest groups, terms of the constituencies. That's what was critical.
Let's go to the Senate race and
okay.
then maybe the congressional races. So what do you think is going to happen now that it's Dianne Feinstein against Kevin DeLeon, the Democratic Senate leader in Sacramento?
Well, I don't see the arithmetic anywhere near favorable to Kevin DeLeon. He's not known statewide, hasn't been. He is a district politician. He's had problems raising money. He does seem to have the energy and the enthusiasm of the progressive left, the Our Revolution, the Bernie-crats.
But the Our Revolution people are not doing very well.
They aren't even trying, I don't think, to tell you the truth. Yes, they've been losing in the primaries. But that's about what he has. I guess that's my point. It appears to me that barring any unforeseen circumstances, of which there are sometimes some, it's a cakewalk for Dianne Feinstein for her record-setting term.
And of course, given who she is, she'll never assume it's a cakewalk, and she'll work and work and work. But two things strike me about this. First of all, the argument against her because of her age will backfire. And
because older voters are hypertensive
voters. But younger voters don't like it. The students I talk to don't like it. They don't think you should automatically disqualify someone because of their age.
Does that make me feel good?
And she looks young with
she
it,
does.
Vigorous, and very involved. Secondly, do you think most people in California, or most Democrats in California, and most Democratic-leaning independents, actually think that Dianne Feinstein isn't a progressive?
Are you kidding me?
Yeah, I mean, that's...
I mean, you know, they're both Democrats, and one may look a little bit more progressive than another, but you just look at her record on gun control, on the environment, and that's one of the things she did, I thought, very well in her ads. She underscored the fact that, yes, she has challenged Trump, and yes, she has been at the forefront of gun control, and yes, she's been at the forefront of the environment. She laid out a record, and De Leon doesn't have that much of a record to lay out.
What argument could he make?
Oh boy. New leadership. Youth.
See, I guess.
Progressivism. Now, I'm not telling you it's going to be effective. You yeah. asked me what he would make.
Oh, no, what he could do. What in your, if you were advising him.
I wouldn't advise any candidate.
Okay, I'm going to stop asking questions, and she's going to stop asking questions, and we're going to invite questions from our Facebook viewers. And while they're coming in, I think we should take one whack at these congressional races.
Okay, go ahead.
Democrats did not get locked out.
They did not.
And Democratic turnout was up significantly over what it had been in 20.
Really? Oh, yeah. I haven't seen the figures
yeah,
yet.
Democratic turnout was up significantly over what it had been in the primaries before.
I heard that it was truly up significantly in Orange County, which bears directly.
But it was also up, for example, in Steve Knight's district, mm-hmm. The Republican in northern Los Angeles County, who I think is vulnerable. There's a poll out today, I know you don't believe in polls, from NBC and the Wall Street Journal. That's a poll I actually very much respect, showing Democrats with a 10-point generic lead, and Republicans or voters saying by 58, I think it's to 22, that they want someone who will be a check on Trump.
Yeah, but how Trump's, at his approval rating went up 4 points. His job approval
isn't that the margin of error?
I don't know. I haven't seen the statistics.
It's about, yeah, that's about points? The margin. Yeah, it's about the margin of error. But the pollsters made the point that what Trump has done is solidify his base. But people still want people who are going to check him. Mm-hmm. They want someone who's going. They want members of Congress who are going to say, "No, you can't do this." So, what do you think the prospects are that Democrats will take 3 or 4 or 5 of these seats?
Of these seats. I think it's again, it will depend on the campaign, it will depend on the candidate, it will depend on the message, it will depend on the turnout, as every election has always depended on. But I don't think that the Democrats have anything to be sad about in the results of the primary elections here. They're going to have to pull hard. I would say at least 3. What do you think?
I think it's going to be maybe even 4, maybe even 5. And I think Donald Trump is the great turnout machine for the Democratic Party. He's
for
the great
get-out-the-vote
machine. But there aren't enough Republicans if he gets them
well,
out. We have a Facebook question.
So oh, good. Okay. Good.
Okay. Does California need a gas tax for roads?
Yeah. I mean, that's the whole point of the gas tax. Has anybody driven on the back roads? Has anybody driven through the humongous potholes in the freeway? Has anybody been prevented from driving anywhere on the freeway because of the clogginess of the traffic? California was built, like it or not, California was built on roads. Yeah, sure.
Well, the gas tax hasn't gone up in this state for nearly 30 years. And the truth is, the last time they raised it, if they'd indexed it, they wouldn't even have had to pass. They wouldn't have had to raise it again. But the unfortunate thing for them is, at the time the legislature did this, gas prices were low. Gas prices by market force have now been driven up higher. And when we withdrew from the Iran deal, they went even higher.
I know. So I hear exactly what you're saying.
But it is the case that there is not a lot of stray money sitting around that's going to do the infrastructure investment that this state needs. And I do not believe that on everything we've seen so far, it does not seem to me that Donald Trump is ever going to get a serious infrastructure package through the Congress.
No, and if he does, it will be by pulling money from other programs, and that gets really dicey.
And that won't get through, I don't think. Second question, why was turnout Tuesday so low?
Was it?
Yeah.
So low?
Well, first of all, people said initially it was 21%. By the time they're done counting all the ballots,
it'll be about 18.
No, it'll go up.
It'll go up.
It'll go up from 21 by the time they count everything. It's traditionally pretty low in the primary. Mm-hmm. It goes much higher in the general. I think the one thing that could encourage Democrats is that, relatively speaking, their turnout in these contested congressional areas was significantly higher than it had been in 2014 and 2016.
But still not overtaking, by and large, the Republican turnout. Here's another
But Democrats come out in the general
election. Yeah. They are more like the general electorate. And I also think that it's very interesting that in terms of turnout, what you are seeing, I think, is this old North-South state conundrum. The South in an electoral has the numbers, but the North has the intensity. And
they all vote, and the North votes as a block.
That's what I mean, exactly.
The North votes as
a
block.
They're much more unified.
I mean, Newsom won Los Angeles.
I mean, he won L.A. County, and Dianne Feinstein in the Senate race won L.A. County, the home turf of Villaraigosa and De Leon.
Although I think Feinstein
Why
is
doing
a...
doing exit polls, darn you?
Feinstein is a statewide figure, I don't think. Not a Bay Area figure anymore. The next question we got is the Me Too movement affecting candidates?
Define affecting. What does that mean?
Well, I think what they mean is it having an impact on these races? And my answer is yes, and it's having two impacts. One, a lot more women are running for office than ever before.
30 made it into the general.
And number two, a lot more women are getting nominated, not just in California, but all across the country. And right now, I think women and even white women who voted for Trump narrowly, but white women are the engines of nominating these women and of supporting Democrats. They have a lot of doubts about Trump.
I agree with you on that, although I'm not really thrilled that only 30 women made it through the primaries in California when you consider how many offices up and down the ballot were up for grabs. But there has been an impact. There is an increase. I think, I hate to use the word empower because it's so overused, but it is true that women who might not have thought about running before have been motivated, if not to run, to participate and to work not only for women, but for men with whom they feel comfortable in terms of their philosophy.
Yeah, so don't just, you know, I think the conclusion the women are coming to is don't just march, run and vote.
You know, you're absolutely right. And one of the things that has frustrated me through my teaching career is this, by and large, and I don't want to diss my colleagues, and it certainly doesn't apply to you, but for too often we've taught civics, vote and you can change the world. You got to vote. No, yes, you have to vote, but you can't stop there.
You have to be involved.
You've got to work before, and you got to stay involved after, and you've got to move some oversight. And that's where I think we've basically failed. And that's why I think that Gen X and millennials are so sour about the whole system. It doesn't work for them because if they vote, it doesn't change.
I'm going to slightly amend this next question. Somebody asked us, is gerrymandering a factor in the Senate races? I think we should say congressional races.
Right.
The only gerrymandering that's a factor in the Senate races goes back to the beginning of the country when each state, regardless of population, was given two senators. So California has two senators. South Dakota has two senators. South Dakota is hardly a congressional district in California.
And if we split it to three states, we'll have six senators.
Yeah, well, and that's not going to happen either, I don't think.
No.
Gerrymandering is certainly a factor. It's a big obstacle.
Less here
because we changed
the
system.
Took it out of the hands of the
nationally.
Legislature.
Nationally, it's one of the big obstacles Democrats have to overcome.
They actually won again the popular vote in total in congressional elections, and the control is in the hands of the Republicans.
Democrats have to win by 6 or 7. Maybe 8 points, depending on what I think. 6 is probably the Passover or the boundary in order to win the House. And that's the one factor. Gerrymandering is one factor. The other factor is the concentration of populations.
Yes.
Democrats tend to live in districts that are very heavily Democratic.
Urban.
Yeah, urban.
Compact.
Yeah.
Self-selection plays a role now.
Yeah.
I mean, this is all a part, I think, of the tribalization of America.
I mean, I'd like us to elect a Democratic member of Congress in North Dakota, but I'm not moving there. I'm nothing against North Dakota. I've been there. It's a lovely place, but I like it here in Southern California. So We're coming to the end of this. Any last comment on your part, and then I'll offer one.
Well, I just want to thank everybody for caring enough about what happened to join us, for questioning where we are going to go as we head toward the fall. And I just want to encourage everybody to get involved, to get with it, get woke, as my students would say. Don't get discouraged.
That's a great civics lesson. I'm not going to offer a final comment. I've said enough. Thank you for joining us live at Studio A at the USC Annenberg School. Bob Shrum, take care. Have fun.
Bye-bye. Sherry Jeffe.
Good.
Thank you so much. That was fun. Yeah. Let's do it again.